Hello and welcome everyone to our first day of spring break at the COC Exploring New Opera. My name is Mackenzie Morgan and I'm going to be your host this week as we uncover many of the diverse career paths that are available within the creative field. Before I introduce our first guest, I would like to proudly acknowledge the traditional lands of not only where I happen to be broadcasting from today, but it is also where I will always consider my home. I acknowledge my Indigenous brothers and sisters who are rooted on Treaty 4 land, situated on the territories of the Cree, the Salto, the Dakota, Lakota, Nakota, and the homeland of the Métis and Mi'kmaq nations. I also acknowledge the ancestral lands of where our guest is broadcasting from, and from where many of you are tuning into today, my Indigenous brothers and sisters who are situated on Treaty 13 land, situated on the territories of the Mississaugas of the Credit, the Anishinaabeg, the Chippewa, the Haudenosaunee, and the Wendat peoples. And now we have to introduce this amazing, amazing composer today, who is the composer of Fantasma, our upcoming original opera for young audiences. I am thrilled and honored to be able to have this conversation with Ian Cusson today. Ian, how are you doing?
I'm doing really well. How are you, Mackenzie?
I'm doing really, really well. We're so excited to have you be our first guest.
Oh my gosh.
For this week. Oh my goodness.
I'm so happy to be here. This is really awesome. This is fun. I like this week.
Yeah, I like it too. And again, we're just so happy that you were able to find some time in your huge, busy schedule to sit down and talk with us a little bit about your career. And I think I'd like to just maybe start and ask you, how did you get into this profession? How did you become a composer? What's your artistic practice? Like, how did this begin? Start from the beginning.
Totally. Well, I come from a really small town. It's a community on Georgian Bay. So for people that are in Toronto, it would be like a 2-hour car drive north. And when I was a kid, like nobody in my community had any interest in opera, or very few did. But I came from a family who had a lot of musical roots. My parents aren't exactly musicians, but they knew that I had sort of musical interest. So they put me in piano lessons when I was 7. And I played on a little tiny keyboard on our dining room table and just really loved it. I loved playing, but I loved playing around, I think, more than I loved like having to play the music that my piano teacher would give me. And actually, that's sort of the beginning of my composing, is that I would fiddle all the time. And I feel like now I'm an adult who gets paid money to fiddle around on the piano or on whatever instruments. And that's really that's been consistent since I was a kid. What I really fell in love with opera when a teacher actually introduced me to it. I had a lot of great music teachers as a young person. Sometimes they were really hard. Like they would challenge me a lot and expect a lot out of me in terms of practicing and that sort of thing. But I always loved to play around when I was not practicing the pieces I was supposed to be playing. And sometimes I'd start to like write them down, because I'd be like, okay, well, I'm learning how to read music, so I could actually write the dots on the page as well. So I started to do that, played a lot more. I had a teacher when I was about, I guess, 11, who said, hey, opera, like it's a thing. Here are some recordings. And they would tell me about the story of operas. And I was like, oh my gosh, this is a crazy, cool thing. And I think what I loved about it so much was that it's like the mixing together of all these different art worlds. Like you've got the theater, you've got storytelling, which I grew up hearing a lot of stories from my grandmother, and you've got music. So it captures your emotions on a level that like just a regular play or even sometimes a movie can't do. And that just hooked me. And I was like, I'm in, I love this thing. I'm going to keep learning about it. And then just kept fiddling. Really, I fiddle professionally. That's what I do. Like, fiddling meaning not like the fiddle, but, you know, like writing stuff.
Yeah. That's amazing. That's so great. Like, so as you know, we're growing up exploring and basically from what I'm hearing, just allowing yourself that opportunity to fiddle and to play and to find and to try. When did you know that being a composer was like, this is what I want to do now? Like, this is what I want to do as a career. Was there a turning point, or was it just, you know, opportunity? How did you know?
Yeah, it was probably in my mid-teens when I was in high school, and I was really getting serious about music, like getting into it, playing in a lot. Like at that time, I played in music festivals, and I would sometimes play like in our high school musicals as the pianist for the musical. Just kind of doing it more and more, and realized like I had this real love of doing that, of making music, but especially kind of making my own music and coming up with my own ideas. Mm-hmm. But the funny thing is that I went off to study music, and then it wasn't actually until I was a little bit older that I came back to composing and really did it as a career. So I had a lot of years away where I still was involved in music, and I would still make music and play the piano and accompany singers and all that kind of stuff. But I had a break between it, and that was also kind of like weirdly good, because it was a time where I was able to grow in other areas, so that when I came back to it, it was like, oh, okay, this is a good fit at this moment in my life.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Wow. Well, we're happy you came back. That's for sure. There's no argument there. So let's move into a little bit. Let's talk a little bit about Fantasma, which is, which is what you have composed for us, for opera for young audiences. Tell us a little bit about your role in Fantasma and what inspired your creativity for this project.
So my role is pretty simply the composer, and I think we all kind of, or most people would understand what a composer is. Like, you write the music for a piece, but it's a role that, as I've even worked through this piece, I've learned what it can mean and what the parts of that role are. What it meant actually is working very closely with my co-partner and co-creator on the project, who is the librettist. So she's the person that wrote all of the words that get sung in the opera. And together, and her name is Colleen Murphy. She's an amazing, amazing playwright and librettist. But together, we actually came up with a story. And it was a really interesting process. We'd have phone calls and meetings, and we would do a lot of this sort of, what if? What about this? What about that? We would just kind of throw ideas out at each other. And sometimes the idea would be like, yes, it would stick in a way that felt very exciting. And then we would grab mm-hmm. onto that idea and be like, okay, so if we've got this, what about if this happened? And so one of those big ideas, I'll give an example, was the idea of a carnival. For her and I, we both had experiences of carnivals in our childhoods. It was called the Fall Fair, and it came to my hometown every fall, and it would be set up and then it would be torn down, and it would leave town. And there was something very magical about that, like a whole world appearing and then disappearing, that was kind of magical in our mind. And then we took that idea and then just sort of built the world around it, imagined what people were inside this carnival. We imagined what would have happened in this space, and the story grew that way. So my role, to answer your question, I'm the composer, but also I had the great privilege of being a part of the process of building that story with my co-creator.
Mm-hmm. And which I think is such a cool combination that you have, that you can say, you know, what I'm hearing is you took ideas, you thought a lot about that process of creating, and not just, you know, we're going to start with music. There's a lot that goes ahead of just writing the music. Yeah. Do you think I know sometimes when I'm writing, something will just spark and words will come and things and ideas will come. And then I just start, you know, writing or saying, if there's something I need to say. Were there any similar experiences in terms of your dialogue with Colleen and just saying, oh yes, you know, and having that moment maybe?
There were so many of those moments. I feel like the whole process of working on this piece, and we worked on it for, I would say, like a year and a half, from like the first ideas, conversations, getting all the words together. And then even before the music came, I mean, it was months and months before any notes of music were written, but it was, it was almost like daily, these kind of, whoa, yes, this idea. And then we would just like scramble to write ideas down. And I think you said something really interesting, and you said process. And I think one really interesting thing that a lot of people, I think, assume an opera is, or especially the way it's put together, is like, there's this one person who has this full idea of, like, let's say, an hour of music in their head, and they just kind of sit at the table and write it down. I think there are some people who work that way. I'm definitely not that person. And nor is Colleen that writer, the librettist. We took teeny tiny, like little ideas that any of us could have, that any of us can hold in our hands. And we just offered each one up, and we sort of like looked at one little idea. And then sometimes you'd find another idea that might match it and go well with it. And it's like putting these little tiny pieces together and to build the story and build the story and build the story. And all of a sudden, after time, after doing that for a while, you've got a story. And then when I came to writing music, it was the same idea. It's like, what about this little idea, you know, like these five notes, or this little grouping of notes, it gives this very maybe mysterious sound. And that was all that kind of came to me, just this one little nugget of an idea. And then that would be added to another one. And I'd ask that question, like I said earlier, well, what if this happened next? What if ba-da-da-dum goes to ba? Ooh, how does that make me feel? Again, I'm not like, the words that I'm saying now are all happening inside my head at the same time, but a lot of the way that I would put this together is just by these little tiny fragments. Nothing whole came to me. It was all just little bits and pieces. And I'd always hold those up to, how did that make me feel? How does it make me feel to hear ba-da-da-dum, boom? Ooh, it gives me this kind of like, this like dark feeling. And ooh, is that the feeling I want in this moment? Yeah, I think so. Okay, well, if we have this dark feeling, what could happen next? Maybe it's a really bright ba that happens after that. Okay, let me try putting those two things together. What happens next? That's basically how I write anything. And that's how I wrote this opera, Fantasma.
Wow. We're getting into the mind, the composer's mind of how that process works. But, you know, just, you know, hearing from what you're saying, it sounds as though it's inquiry based. We think about inquiry based learning, like in terms of school, but it's very interesting to see how that also translates into the creative space as well. Like, what about this? Let me try that. And giving yourself the autonomy to, and the courage maybe to say, oh yeah, no, that doesn't work. Or, oh, I love this. And I think, you know, knowing that that's part of the way that you and Colleen have kind of constructed this together, that's a new way of, you know, of working and collaboration. So
that's awesome. I would encourage, if anybody is joining this that would like to consider writing opera in the future. Mm. I mean, I think I can't overemphasize what you just said, is this, like you said, inquiries, asking these questions, exploring. And I think the other really critical word, at least for my process, is play. I've got some young kids, and when they started out school, it was very different than when I was in school, but they have this whole play-based learning in the early years of school. And so it's like, mm-hmm. you'd go to class and you go to, you know, they're in, say, junior kindergarten, and they move from this little station to that little station, and it's all like blocks and it's sand and it's different things that you can get your fingers in. And you'd think like, oh, well, they're not learning anything, but they're learning to like, cut with scissors. Like, that's an actual skill. They're also learning to like build things and count blocks as they play. So they're playing, but they're also absorbing all this information. And that's basically, I'm like a big kid, basically. I just do that. And even you think like, oh, opera, it's so, it could be stuffy, or like, who could do that? But it's really just like be a 5-year-old again, and and just play around. The other thing I was going to say is I was thinking about this before we chatted, was there's also this real question of going, is my idea any good? And all of us as composers or creators, we all have this weird voice, and it always sits at the back of our head. And as much as I can, I try to turn it off, but it usually says something like, is that any good? Like, will people like that? Are you going to get laughed at for that? That voice, I tell you, in my old age, is still in the back of my head. And usually I spend most of my day just either ignoring it or telling it to go away. And then I just keep playing, right? Mm-hmm. Because what I've learned, and this is a, I hope people will hear this who are especially interested in composing, is that often the ideas, the musical ideas that we come up with, are actually really good. And I think more often than not, we question if they're good, and we'll throw them out. It's almost like you write it on a piece of paper and you throw it in a fire because you're like, that's not good enough. But actually that idea, what I find is if I'm generous with myself and I go, no, I'm going to let that idea sit, it usually is actually a pretty good one. And I think if I could go back and talk to myself when I was like 15, right, I would say, don't be so hard on yourself about what you write. Probably I threw out too much good music when I was in my teen years that was like actually good, but I just was so personally critical of it. So I would say, like, yeah, like the big job of, and this happened all through writing Fantasma as a composer, is really just learning to manage that voice. The voice is always going to be there, and there's an acceptance of that. But also just saying to that voice, like, it's playtime right now. I'm going to throw some sounds together and you can go and do something else right now. I'll call you back later when I've got all these notes on the page and I need your advice, you know?
We'll call you when we need you. Don't call us. We'll call you.
Exactly.
I think that's important, because I think, you know, even just as artists, we all have that voice of doubt. And that voice that can maybe cause anxiety or nerves or uncertainty about the journey and about finding that way through the dark. And for me, I think I love what you said about it's time to play. It's time to kind of encompass all of the good, the bad, and the ugly. It's just you're embracing all of that. I think it's important as artists to embrace that, because it is part of the creative process.
Yeah.
And I always used, I had a great teacher who always said to me, you know, you don't want the fear to go away, because the fear actually motivates you to overcome that. And when you do overcome that, what a feeling to know that fear was there all the time, that you were able to overcome that. So I think that's really special that you even with the accolades that you have, Ian, that you still, you know, kind of feel sometimes, oh, is this right or is this not? But having that trust in yourself and knowing that this is part of the process, and it's part of encompassing that and embracing that and not trying to ignore it.
Totally.
I think is healthy and empowering as well.
It totally is. Yeah. And like I say, I have that daily, multiple times a day. There is not a day where I do not have that. And I think that's important to say. Even as I do more work, I think I build in confidence, because I can look back at previous things I've done and go, oh, that was, I like that. Or sometimes I go, oh, there's things I'd change in that. But you still like, that was pretty good, or I'm happy with that. So your confidence builds, which is a great thing, but still that piece is always there. And I think being friendly to that part, that voice, and not just saying you have to leave, but rather just like go busy yourself with something else is the right way. I was going to say, you know, one thing, and I've been working on another piece recently, and so this thought is very fresh, but there's always a point in writing music where you get stuck. And I'm talking like it happens multiple times a day. You write an idea, you might go, okay, I really like that. It's you know, it's 10 seconds of music that I've really, really liked. What the heck happens next? I have no idea. And it can feel, that feeling can be very, very frightening, because then what happens is that little voice that we were just talking about comes back and goes, oh, Ian, are you going to figure it out? Maybe you're not good enough to figure it out, or whatever it might be. And for me, the one of the best things that I've discovered is that sometimes actually just stepping away from trying to figure out that idea, and often things like brushing my teeth or drinking a glass of water or just walking around the block with my dog, I can come back and I wasn't thinking for a second about what would happen next, but somehow at some weird spot in the brain, that idea got resolved. And then I come back to my office and it's like, oh, what about this? Or I'm just more easy with it. And I just start asking those what questions, what could happen next? And so I think acknowledging those blocks that we get, and I think all artists get that, all creatives get that, and saying, nope, that's just part of the process. And what's a good way to get past that? You know, just be nice to yourself and be easy on yourself and push past.
And I'm sure, you know, as you were creating Fantasma, I'm sure there were those roadblocks along the way. But overall, what would you say is the overview of that story? Like you were talking about how yourself and Colleen would put pieces together and then kind of weave the blueprint of what the story, you know, would look like, both musically and obviously for the performers on the stage. Can you give us a little insight as to what that overview of the story was, and kind of maybe what you were at the end, once you went through that creative process, at the end, what you really wanted to kind of portray to the audience and the listener?
So both Colleen and I like to work in a certain way where we don't usually approach our work by saying, what kind of message or what kind of themes do we want people to get out of it? We usually discover that after we've written something. And the place that we usually start is maybe a location. For example, the carnival was the setting of the piece. But then also, like, who's there? Who are the people that are there? So in short, this story is really about two 15-year-old girls, one named Leia and one named Ivy. They're best friends, and they come together to like a day at this like local carnival. It could be the CNE in Toronto, if people are familiar with that, or it could be one of these local fairs. And it's kind of a beat up older carnival, so it's like maybe a little on the like creepy side. Some of the people that work there are a little strange. And so the girls are like, it's a little bit lame that we have to be here. They also got dragged along by Leia's mom, and who has her like 6-month-old brother there. So it's like, it's not the most fun day, but what we sort of enter the world with these strange characters of the carnival, and these girls like, oh my gosh, I want to get out of here, to them getting lost actually at the carnival and finding themselves inside this ride, which is the Haunted Manor ride. And they think they have seen one of the workers at the carnival wearing this like ghost sheet. But what they discover is actually there's a boy who lives inside of this ride, inside of this like Haunted Manor building, and he's dead. And he lives there, and he's lived there for some time. And first of all, the girls are like, oh my gosh, this is like a dead child. What the heck is going on? Yeah. And they kind of get their nerves under them and talk to him. And they learn a little bit about his story of how he got there. And what happens starts from a really boring day for the girls. They actually move to a place of like feeling really deeply for this boy. His name is Marcel, and actually moving to a place of trying to help him escape this place. And so that becomes their journey and their motivation. And so the story really follows that and watches what sort of the results of their trying to help him are. One of the things we tried to do is imagine two different sound worlds in the piece. So the first sound world is the kind of mysterious world of Marcel. And is it okay that I play a little bit? I have a
yes. Oh yes. Oh,
okay.
Please.
Yeah. I'll give in like little snapshots.
Let's hear
of what,
it. I'd love
what
it.
These two worlds are. So if you were to think of this, like imagine like a black, you're in darkness and you see this little glowing white head. It's like the top of a sheet. It's just glowing in the darkness and you heard this music under it. So this is a little hint. a little hint of this kind of Marcel music. And even though they're the youngest people in the opera, the two girls and this younger boy, I really feel like the heart of the story exists around them. It's really their story. And the rest of the world, this other musical world, is the world of the carnival, which is like bigger than life. It's a little bit like it's a little bit off. Everything is a little bit wonky. So there's this kind of music that we get at one point, and it sounds, I'll just play a little tiny bit of it, but. So it's this ba 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 ba. It's very, very different from the music of the little boy of this inside world of the carnival. And at one point they all get on a carousel. And there's this very, I think it's a pretty little melody, but if you listen for just a second, you'll hear that it a little bit goes off the rails, and it sounds a little bit strange. So it starts out really beautiful like this. And it continues on, but you get these, it's a little, oh, is it out of tune?
Yeah.
Maybe that would have been a better note, but I give you. So everything is a little bit slanted on its side in this carnival world. And I think what I tried to do is create a musical world that could bring to life some of these like fantastic people that live in this space. And that's really, if I were to think about like, what is the job of the composer in an opera? I think the job of the composer is really to find the musical language of the story that you're telling. And that can look so many different ways, but sometimes to think about a musical language, I usually think in terms of emotions, and pretty much that's the only way I think. Like, is this a little bit creepy? Is this a little bit fearful? Is this extremely happy? Is it like so happy that it's almost fake happy? Like it's like candy? Or is it a kind of like, I don't know. Is it really dark and really like, really macabre? And I usually think of those kind of words and then create music to match those feelings or those qualities of the space. And one of the things I'll do is as I'm setting words to music that the singers on the stage are going to sing, let's say they're singing something like, I'm so happy, right? You could be like, I'm so happy, you know, but underneath them, is it like, I'm happy? Or is it like, I'm so happy? Oh, are you happy? And sometimes you can actually, like the music can agree with what's being said. And sometimes the music can be like, I don't know if she's happy right now. I think she's not telling us the full truth. So you can start to play those kind of games about like, what are they really feeling in this moment? And that's the great fun of being a composer of opera.
Well, I mean, there's so much to chew and absorb with what you've just said there, but I think the coolest thing is that you have this ability to communicate emotions in a nonverbal way. Like, even when you made that example of are you happy with kind of the crazy music underneath that didn't really agree with maybe what was being verbally said, it was so clear that, you know, that of what you were trying to kind of allude to, which I always, you know, I always envy with composers that they're able to, you know, like as a singer, you sing the words and those words are internalized and at times you have to submit to the words.
Yeah.
But with composition, you communicate in such a beautiful way, like so many things that are said that aren't said. I loved the way that you described that. So that's going to be my big takeaway. I don't know about anybody else, but that'll be my takeaway for sure.
It's funny if I can just say to that. Yeah, I think like the greatest job of well, I think this is okay. I'm going to make a big statement now. The greatest job of any artist, but especially a composer, especially of opera, is to be endlessly fascinated by human beings. One of the things, like if you want to learn how to be a composer, and I think of some of the people that are listening, I hope there are people that are like, I've always thought of writing something, maybe I'll try. I would say go and try, do it.
and have a
blast doing it. But it's the best tool, the best learning that you can get. Of course, to learn music is good and important, but it's really just to have your eyes wide open about people. Maybe it's the people in your life. Maybe it's like your sister. Maybe it's the way your dog reacts to the postman. Maybe it's the way your parents interact and you kind of see like, are they happy right now? Or maybe are they fighting, but they're using really pretty words. And you can learn so much about the way human beings work and interact. Sometimes people say things with their mouth, but I think they have a very different question underneath. Maybe they're really afraid and they're saying something very mean with their mouth, but they're scared. So as if you were then to be a composer, right, in that moment, and you wanted to set that musically, you could imagine, maybe I have a really intense vocal line that's like sounds like screaming almost in singing, right? But then underneath it, you show something of the fear, something of there's something, another thing underneath that. And all of a sudden, what you've done as an artist is you've created this complex human being in that moment. They're not just a character. They're like a fully fledged human being. And the audience goes, oh, like, whoa, I'm watching something real. In some ways, we're creating false things as artists to make them look as real as possible and to somehow have a connection point to what life is like, what the real life is like.
Yeah.
And that's the great fun of being a composer.
Well, it's finding that authentic, because we all have layers. We all have those, you know, we all have those parts within us that, you know, you got to get up, you got to keep going, you got to get to school, you got to get to work. But inside, internally, there's an internal dialogue that happens. And so I think that it's brilliant that you've been able to find a way to kind of demonstrate and illustrate that authentic, we all go through those experiences, but to be able to illustrate that in a musical way, that is exciting. That is pretty cool, Mr. Ian.
My favorite part of my job is that and getting to talk to people like you.
Oh, thank you. Well, we know that and we've heard from you of all of the great and amazing things that come through the process. But we live in a society where, you know, perfection, Instagram, filters, everything has to be right and everything has to be a certain way. So my question is, you know, as a creator, I think, and even as an artist, any type of creative person, we learn most from our mistakes. Oh, and we learn from, you know, we learn from trial and we learn from error. And in our mistakes is really where I know personally where I grow the most is when I go through those peaks and valleys. So my question to you would be, what is the biggest lesson that you've learned from making a mistake? It doesn't have to be Fantasma related. It could just be in some of the other experiences that you've had. So what is the biggest lesson that you've learned, and how did this mistake improve your craft?
Such a great question. I mean, I have to say, mistakes can be the scariest thing. And I think the fear of making a mistake, not even making one, but just the thought of making one and maybe being embarrassed, like what will happen? Will I be embarrassed in front of people? Like there's all those feelings. That's the scariest thing. But mistakes are the best thing, point blank, for growing as a human being, for growing as an artist, for growing as a creative. I feel like all of the best things that I've learned in life and in music specifically have come from making mistakes. And the biggest challenge, like I said, is feeling confident in making the mistake. Like someone once said to me, I think they said like screw up, but screw up boldly. In a musical context, right? You could say like, if you're going to make a mistake, just make a huge one. And what they were really saying to me is like, just embrace it. Embrace it as a beautiful thing that you might feel discomfort with. You might feel embarrassment with. You might feel a lot of different feelings with, but it will be your greatest kind of guide and teacher along the way. So, I mean, it's hard for me to isolate one example because I feel like every day is a series of mistakes in some ways, if you think about it. And like we were saying earlier, every time I sit to write, even before I show music to people, I will try out five different ways of, remember we were saying like, I'm happy, and then putting that weird chord underneath. That might've been the fifth thing that I tried out of 10. And so if you were to think of it, like the nine other ones were mistakes or they didn't work, but they got me to the place of going, no, I think this is the best idea out of the 10 that I've looked at. Sometimes, you know, especially when you think you're done writing a piece, like that's another question or another thought that I have is like, when do you know you're done? Right.
Yeah.
Sometimes you think you're done and you have to give the music to the singers and the players to learn. And if you're lucky and if you time yourself the right way, you often can get it to them early enough that you might actually get them to sing through it once for you. And you might go, oh, that didn't work as well as I thought it would, or that's a lot more awkward for them. And then you can change it. But that's the other great way is becoming good friends with other creatives who they want to see you succeed and you want to see them succeed. Like for example, if I was writing even Fantasma, I've had the incredible benefit at the Canadian Opera Company of having what we've called workshops, where we took different versions of the music and we gave it to these incredible singers, some of whom you're going to hear from later this week. And they were able to sing it, to ask me questions, to be like, and I would ask them lots of questions. I'd say, is that awkward? Is that strange? What do you think about that? And if you stay really open to that, they're helping you out by helping make these mistakes better, but you're also helping them out because you're going to give them something that maybe feels more satisfying to sing and or play. And so what you do is you're really caring about each other, but you're also caring about the work that you're making, and the work that you're making becomes better and better and better. And then at the end, it's like, oh, what a great composition, Ian. And I'm like, thank you. But thank you to all the people that were with me who made it that. And hopefully they're also hearing, oh, what great singing. And they can say, well, thank you. And also I'm glad that we made those changes because it made me feel way more relaxed to sing that line after I told Ian that it was a really bad idea. You know, so we're there for each other. And those mistakes are the places of learning and growing.
And it's part of what I'm hearing. It's part of the process. So, you know, it's, And you said again, I'm going back to your idea of the play, and maybe this will work or maybe that won't work. And I think it's good to think about mistakes in that way, where that's just part of the process, and we can kind of eliminate ideas based on that collaboration that you have with the artistic team. So what if I want to start thinking about my mistakes in that way and just saying it's part of getting to the end goal.
And of course, we all want to make mistakes safely. And I think that that's a really important thing is to say, is to for you, meaning all of us as creatives, to say, what are the spaces that I feel safe in and that I feel comfortable in? I don't necessarily want to go, like, imagine, like, I don't know, I'll use a funny example, like on American Idol or like in front of millions of people and make a mistake there. I don't think I'd feel very comfortable doing that. And I probably would never put myself into that space. But if I have a team of people that are friends and it's like five people, or even if it's one person who you say, listen, I want to show you this thing. I don't know if it's good or bad. I'm really kind of just, I'm not sure about it. Can I just like give it to you to look at? Someone that you trust, that is the place where you can feel safe to make those mistakes. And hopefully, as we all go forward with the creative work that we do, that circle can expand and more people can fit into that safe bubble that you're willing to show it to before you get it in front of a million people.
Yeah, that's great. That is some great advice there. Oh my goodness. Ian, I could sit and chat with you all day.
Oh my gosh, I love it.
We could get some tea, so have a little lunch. It would be perfect.
I'd love
But
it.
I can't believe we're already winding down. So my last question of the hour is, why do you think young people in particular should come and see this production of Fantasma? What do you hope they will be able to absorb and kind of take away from the experience?
Oh, so many things, but the thing that I love, and I'll speak personally, is why I love the opera and why I love the theater, especially when we can be together in person, which I know is difficult right now, but is because you can be transported away. And I know we can be transported away when watching Netflix or watching a movie or whatever, but there's something really special to be in a space where people, like, first of all, people are making sounds with their bodies, their voices, which is like superhuman. It's like you're watching Marvel superheroes on stage. What they can do and the amounts of sound that they can make and the stories they can tell with their bodies, like their voices, is incredible. And being in the room with them, you feel it in your chest when someone sings something very powerful. And there are some powerful moments in this piece where you're going to be like, oh, like I can feel my inside shaking. You can only get that in the theater. But I hope that you'll come and just be taken away, be transported, leave the space thinking and feeling more than anything, more than thinking. I hope you leave the space feeling deeply about the characters that you engaged with over this work. And thinking at the same time about your own life and the things that are important to you. That's why I make opera. That's why I make musical work, is that people can have a deep experience with it. And I really think that this is one of those pieces where there are so many places to grab on and to just and to feel deeply and go on that magical journey that you can only experience really together in that space.
Oh, I can't wait for
Oh,
this
me
to
too.
come. Oh, we just have to get through this, these few more months of this pandemic, and hopefully we'll be able to
Know.
experience that. I'm very excited and so thankful that you were able to join us today for our first day. What a treat. I don't know how we can go on
Oh
from here.
my gosh.
We started at the top of the mountain, so it's only up to Mount Everest, I guess, now or where we can go. But I'm so glad. Thank you so much, Ian,
Thank
for
you.
joining us today. And to our audience, I hope you learned and absorbed a lot. I know I did. if you want to learn more about Ian and what he is doing and kind of the way that his path is moving, you can look for more information on him on our website, coc.ca/springbreak. And if you've enjoyed today's session and are interested in exploring some of our other digital programming that we have available at the COC, you can check us out with Opera Everywhere. And you can find that at coc.ca/everywhere. So be sure to join us tomorrow for From the Performer's Perspective. You'll meet us at the same time, 2:00, and you'll be hearing from Matthew Cairns and Alex Soloway, who are some of the performers and collaborative pianists for Fantasma. So I hope you all have enjoyed and learned from Ian and from this experience. And we look forward to seeing you tomorrow. If there are some people you want to make sure to tell and join us, please join us. It's just been such a great way to start off the week, and we cannot wait to see you again tomorrow. Thank you so much again, Ian, and thank you, everyone.
Thanks, everybody.
Bye-bye.